Hello, everyone. Welcome to all the team executives and media members to this event. Thank you for being here today. It's a historic day and a major announcement as we have all 11 professional sports organizations in Greater Los Angeles have joined together today to form the Alliance Los Angeles. I'd like to introduce those leaders to you at this time who are joining us today. From the Anaheim Ducks, Aaron Teets, President of Business Operation. From the Anaheim Ducks, the head coach, Dallas Aikens. From the Los Angeles Angels, their chairman, Dennis Kuhl, and their president, John Carpino. From the Los Angeles Chargers, the President of Business Operations, A.G. Spanos. From the LA Clippers, President of Business Operations, Gillian Zucker. From the Los Angeles Dodgers, President and CEO, Stan Kasten. From the Los Angeles Dodgers, their manager, Dave Roberts. From LAFC, their president and co-owner, Tom Penn. From the LAFC and the Dodgers, their owner, Peter Guber. From the LA Galaxy, President Chris Klein. From the LA Galaxy, their broadcaster and a great player, Kobe Jones. From the Los Angeles Kings, AHL scout, growth and inclusion specialist, Blake Bolden. From the Los Angeles Lakers, Chief Operating Officer, Tim Harris. From the Los Angeles Rams, their head coach, Sean McVay. From the Los Angeles Sparks, their president and chief operating officer, Danita Johnson. And from the Play Equity Fund and LA 84 Foundation, their president and CEO, Renata Simrell. Before we get to the program, I'd like to remind the media after the comments, we encourage you to use the question and answer feature on Zoom to ask any questions you may have of our panelists here today. We ask that you keep these questions specifically to the Alliance rather than any questions they may have surrounding each individual's team current operations. And to start our program off, I'm going to call on Tom Penn, the LAFC president and co-owner. Tom, you'll have the opening comments. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, everyone, for joining. It's really a pleasure seeing the array of faces and the representation of the greatest sports city on the planet. This is really, really a cool moment, and we honor and recognize everybody for being here. The first thing I want to do is thank and recognize the senior leaders of all 11 organizations. On May 31st, we came together for the first time. That was the morning after the city erupted. And everybody, to a man and woman, co-signed on the idea that we would collectively try to work together to bring some good out of the situation. We felt like, if not sports, then who? We didn't know what we would do or how we would do it, so we quickly diversified our group and added 11 more voices, really important voices from our organization. So I want to recognize the other 11 individuals who came and joined this group and helped forge the Alliance in terms of the programming and the stature of what we're doing. You know, our goal is pretty simple. It's to unite as allies. In many cases, we're rivals, but in this case, we're allies to push for against racial injustice, to take on important issues in communities of color, and particularly the Black community. We expect this alliance to be a beacon and a magnet for cooperation and collaboration in Los Angeles, in greater Los Angeles. You know, in LA, we're partnering with the Play Equity Fund, and we've made a 5-year commitment collectively to support and increase access to sports and structured play programs for youth. This is in communities of color to promote lifelong well-being. As we all know, sports can have so many positive influences on young people's lives. And we needed a rock star to help us with this. We needed a resource, a partner. And Renata Simrell is a rock star in the LA community. She's president and CEO of the LA 84 Foundation and of the Play Equity Fund. And I'd like to introduce Renata and turn it over to her to talk about the notion of play equity and how the Alliance is collaborating. Thank you again.
Thanks, Tom. And thanks to each of the 11 teams, their ownership group and their leadership group. I'm inspired today and I'm ever so grateful. The ownership, leadership and staff and athletes of each of these teams have been inspired, as Tom so eloquently mentioned, and committed to meet this pivotal moment in history, to do more, to get involved in meaningful ways as allies in the fight for social justice and to address the disparities that communities of color, particularly Black communities, continue to experience. And the work that we are going to engage in over the next 5 years is critically important. You know, kids from poor communities have an obesity rate that is nearly 2 times higher than kids from affluent communities. Poor students are 5 times more likely to drop out of high school than students from high-income families, and Black and Latinx youth have the highest rates of stress, anxiety, and depression. We believe that play equity is a social justice issue, and there are a lot of reasons why. Funding is one. Lack of enrichment programs, including sports and physical education in school, is another. Lack of volunteers, coaches, and mentors. Safe passage to playgrounds. This is all a hindrance to positive engagement activities for kids and to their connection for support systems that help them realize their true potential. And it's a hindrance to their academic and success in school. And we know from our work, both at the LA 84 Foundation and the Play Equity Fund, that sports and play can transform children's lives, both on and off the field. When kids play, they are healthier, both physically and mentally, and do better in school. but it requires access and opportunities. So we are excited and we're grateful to partner with the Alliance Los Angeles to address these and other barriers to access that limits kids from their true potential and to allow them to reach success in their lives. So thank you for allowing us to be your partner on this journey, and we look forward to getting to work tomorrow. Steve, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you, Renata. We're going to call on four of our panelists to speak now, and batting in the number one spot and representing the sport of baseball and the Los Angeles Dodgers, I'd like to call on my good friend Dave Roberts.
How are we doing, guys? First off, Renata, Tom, you guys nailed it. And for me, the Los Angeles Dodgers, the Dodger Foundation, we're honored, we're humbled to be a part of this initiative. And it's amazing. As professionals, we all compete individually as organizations, but it's really great to see us come together as people collaborate as one, the Alliance of Los Angeles, which obviously covers greater Los Angeles, for the greater good. And I know that our players are excited about this. I know that me being the first African-American minority manager of the Los Angeles Dodgers, it took people when I was younger to invest in me. And so for us to commit to these communities of color, particularly Black communities, and have that 5-year commitment, I'm hopeful that this spurs a movement. And so again, from the Dodgers, the Dodger Foundation, we're very fortunate and excited to be a part of this.
Thank you, Dave. And we go from one motivator to another motivator, the head coach of the Los Angeles Rams, Sean McVay.
Thanks, Steve. I appreciate it. Like Coach Roberts said, it surely is a pleasure to be here. And when you look at the power and the platform that we have in sports to be able to really affect and influence change, I think that's what's so special about what Renata, Tom, and a lot of these great leaders have put together. And we're humbled and flattered to be a part of it. I think one of the things that has been a consistent theme with us, and I was actually talking with Doc Rivers about this a few weeks back, and this was with the pandemic, with everything going on, he said the best thing about being still and present is you're able to really connect with your players, and it's not about rushing to get a coaching point to them or to get ready for the next game. That being still, being more present has enabled us to open up lines of communication that maybe didn't exist before. And I know for me personally, the thing that's been so powerful about sports is, you know, really you eliminate the prejudice and the stereotypes that unfortunately exist in our society, because you're just seeing great men or great women that have had a huge impact on my life growing up around the arena that we're all fortunate enough to be a part of. But what's been great about being still and being present is now you're able to ask some questions and get some insight and some feedback from our players, from our staff, that truly has enabled me personally to have that empathy that you talk about, to have that understanding. We've been talking about really listening to learn. And now I think this 5-year commitment from all of the organizations on this call is really a demonstration of, all right, we're ready to have our actions in alignment with our words. I've heard it said before, you can preach a better sermon with your life than your lips. And I think this epitomizes that. We're proud to be here and we can't wait to roll our sleeves up and get to work and really make a change for the better.
Well said, Sean, well said. Representing the Los Angeles Kings, she's their AHL Scout Growth and Inclusion Specialist. She was also the first Black player to play on the USA women's hockey team. We'd like to welcome Blake Bolden. Blake?
Thank you so much. This is such an exciting announcement. The Kings are very proud, and me personally, I am so excited about the Alliance. We're here because of sport, right? And sports are such a positive in people's lives. I'm a sports fan, I'm a professional athlete, and from pro sports all the way to youth sports, it brings people together. And while sports teams do hold a special place for fans, as an athlete, we can work to create more opportunities in youth sports for young people who have been left out. Looking back, It was just a coincidence that I played hockey. I was the only Black person playing hockey in every rink that I went to, Black woman included. Okay, my mom's just so happened to date a man that loved the game of hockey. I was brought to games, I watched it, and those players inspired me to say, hey, I wanna pick up a stick. You know, growing up in a Black community, it was evident that the challenges and the access that I have, it just wasn't fair. And I don't want it to be a coincidence anymore for more Black and brown kids to be playing more sports. And that just goes against everything that we stand for, are those unfairnesses. And so we are committed to doing more and more and getting involved in meaningful ways as allies in the fight against racial injustices. We want to level that playing field, drive more opportunities for youth in sports, because sports has that powerful impact on the youth. And with the Alliance, this is a chance to show the real power of sport.
Thank you, Blake. Our final speaker, representing the sport of basketball, the president and COO of the LA Sparks, Danita Johnson. Danita?
Hi, good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for having me. So excited to be here. We're just so proud to be a part of this Alliance. I think it's really impactful that we all come together as sports teams. As Blake mentioned, you know, this is the uniqueness that we get to offer. And even for us, we're the only female professional team here in LA, and being involved and finding our own way and even creating a space for young women throughout this platform and helping to be that leading voice in that is something that we're very excited about. I think there's a lot of work to be done. I think Renata and her team has an amazing vision, and together we have the power to impact lives. And this five-year commitment starts today, and I think 5 years from now we'll all be able to look back and be really proud of the work that we were able to do and accomplish together, and see that next generation of athletes coming through and gaining access to these programs. Not only that, gaining confidence, feeling a part of something where maybe they didn't before. So very excited about the work that we're going to be able to do together. And so proud of the Alliance. And I think LA, our markets are a representation of what many other markets can be doing to increase and bring awareness in their spaces. And I'm just so proud that we get to help lead the way in that.
Thank you. Our program now will shift to Q&A, and if any media is interested in asking a question, they should type their question and who it's directed to in the Q&A feature of Zoom, and I will direct the questions out. If any media is interested in any one-on-one opportunities with any of our participants, they can email myself or Ricky Zeller of LA84 Foundation, and we will facilitate those requests. I also suggest that you also call the team's PR directors in arranging interviews along those lines. So the first question goes to Coach McVay and Dave Roberts from Jim Hill of KCBS. What will you tell your players about their obligations to the community with this Alliance?
I'll let Coach McVay go first. How about that?
Yeah, no, I appreciate that, Dave. You let us off, so I'll go ahead and lead us off here. You know, Jim, it's I wish I could see you, man. It's always good to hear from you. But what I think you want to do really is give them an understanding of what this represents and different ways that they can get involved, whether it's the educational opportunities, just really having your life be representative of what's right. But I think as we're navigating through getting this thing started, there's so many different things. I was talking with Renata before we got started with the big program, and what a great job she's done of setting up platform for us to get involved, and whether it's providing equipment for guys to be active, whether it's making videos, just there's going to be a lot of different things. And I think more than anything, Jim, it's giving them those options and what really resonates with them, because then it feels authentic and genuine. And then you're using this platform for exactly what the intent is. And that's making a change and having that that equity be more representative of everything, not just sports.
Yeah. Coach, well said. I think for me, and a little bit to echo, you know, what Coach McVay's earlier point was as far as being present, I think now with what's happened, you know, in our country, the players are asking a lot of hard, crucial, intelligent questions on what they can do. And this is people of color, people not of color. And I think that for us having an opportunity, a platform, responsibility, I think it's just, you know, we preach in our clubhouse a lot of, you know, being a servant to others. And I think that when you have an opportunity to look out and look out for others and how you can, you know, benefit them. And, you know, when we're in sports, we get so consumed with our day-to-day lives. And so I know that this initiative right here where, you know, a young kid can turn on the TV and any sport that they turn on, any one of our teams, you know, they know that we're investing in them and their community. And that's special. And I think that this is a step in the right direction. But I think for me, Jimmy, you said it, it's I think it's a responsibility. And I think that fortunately, we're around a group of young, great young men and women that understand the responsibility we all have.
All right, our next question is from Mario Solis at NBC4 Sports. He'd like to know who spearheaded the Alliance project. So I think, Tom, do you want to handle that or Renata?
Yeah, sure. I can handle that. It was really a collective effort. I mentioned on Sunday morning, the group convened and asked, could we get together this afternoon? So that afternoon, and at 4 o'clock on a Sunday, everybody agreed to come together in a Zoom just like this. And it was really more to ask the important question. We didn't have the answer, but we were just asking the question, what could we do together? You know, would we be willing to work together? And we had had a step in that direction actually with COVID-19 and an initial response where we put out a video collectively and we all had several of our players and folks from each club or team franchise participate. So there was already this little baby step with all of us together. And we picked up where we left off with that. And the presidents of all the organizations effectively got together, the leaders on the business side of the operation, just to ask that question. And then, as I said, then we got together 48 hours later with 11 more really important members of our organizations because we needed to hear from them and have them help shape this. And we came with a diverse group of people in background, in age, in expertise. And it was a really cool experience, a really synergistic experience for all of us.
Let me just add on to that because I was one of the folks that was brought in 48 hours later. And, you know, just to underscore Tom's point about the team leadership coming together on that Sunday. And, you know, I was impressed with the fact that several team presidents spoke up and say, we want to use this opportunity to listen and to, you know, really learn how we can have an impact. And it was very much around, you know, not only in the press conference, but really, you know, how do we create a program? How do we create lasting impact? And so the response of the teams in terms of coming together that Sunday, but then taking the time to really create an alliance and a program and a partnership that's going to have impact over the long term was very, very impressive to me, you know, having been a third generation Angelino and a huge sports fan, for the sports teams to come together like they've done. It's just been historic to my mind. And so just a kudos to the ownership, the leadership of all the teams of coming together for this historic moment.
Thank you, Renata. Question from Tony Cabrera at KABC7. What will people in Southern California start to see first from the Alliance? Renata, do you want to handle that one?
Speaker's not working. Hold on a quick second.
Did you hear my question?
Yeah, I did. My speaker's not working. So I don't know what's going on here.
You're okay, Renata. Go ahead.
Oh, you can hear me? Great. Steve, can you repeat the question really quickly, please? I was trying to get my speaker working.
Tony Cabrera from KBC7. He wanted to know, what will people in Southern California start to see first from the Alliance?
Sure. The first thing that they'll see from Alliance is a symposium virtual panel we're putting on next Wednesday, July 22nd, to really dig a little bit deeper into the work that we're going to be engaging in. And I think, you know, my conversation with LZ yesterday is that change in the communities that we're working in doesn't happen overnight. And I think the importance of the teams coming together over a five-year period of time is critically important. And so we are engaged, I've already have engaged two of our social justice organizations who will be working with us on this initiative. And then the next step for us is to engage our community organizations that are going to be part of this alliance partnership and standing up a cohort of young leaders. It's targeted toward 14 to 18 year old young kids. The importance of that is to be able to stay with them over that five-year period of time, to be able to track impacts such as graduation rate and then entering college, and then that college retention rate, which is so critical for Black and Brown communities over a five-year period of time. And we're going to continue to promote the work that we're doing and the progress that we're making, but I do ask for patience, you know, with the media, that this is really trying to change systems here. We're trying to be engaged in this over the long term, and change in the communities in which we are supporting is not going to happen overnight, but the teams are committed to stay with this alliance and this partnership to make sure that we're driving impactful change in the communities who need it most. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you, Renata. Question from Jim Alexander from the Southern California Newspaper Group. What do you do to make sure this initiative lasts through the five-year period and beyond? He's directing that to both NBA representatives, Gillian Zucker and Tim Harris, but said others can chime in as well.
Gillian, you want to go first?
Sure, happy to. Thanks, Tim.
Okay.
You know, we have talked about this as a group, and one of the reasons why we brought in Renata and the Play Equity Fund is because it's very important that we have measurables. So specific KPIs will be created in order to track the progress of the work that's being done. And we'll be checking in on it periodically in order to understand the progress that's being made and to make changes along the way to make sure that what we're doing here really is having a substantive impact on the communities we're looking to affect.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that is, you know, so far all we've done today is just to announce that we intend to do. We've done nothing. And, you know, I think the intent of announcing this is so that we are held accountable and that we do the good work and the hard work over the long period of time. And the onus is upon these 11 teams and Play Equity to do the right things over the long term, over and over and over. This is not about hyperbole. We're not getting together here today to say that we intend to boil the ocean. What we're doing is getting together to say, we're going to take a little part of the ocean. We're going to try and boil that. And hopefully that motivates others to do the same. And we can do this. We can repeat it over and over and over. And then in 5 years, what I hope is that we can look back and say that we have had some successes. We've had some wins, and we repeat the process and do it for another 5 years, because we got here. It took us 400 years to get here. We're not going to get out of this overnight, but the only way we are going to get out of this is to start taking positive baby steps.
Thank you, Tim. Question from Nikki K from Spectrum. The question posed to Dave Roberts. You mentioned those who helped you succeed as a young Black man. What do you think can be done for those community leaders today to help give them the best support to set kids up for success?
Well, I think that, you know, there's got to be places for young kids to go to. There's got to be transportation. You know, when you're talking about a lot of single parent homes, I fortunately had good friends that would take me to the Y and get me to games when my parents were both working, couldn't do that. And so I think that, as Tim said, you know, it's all of us coming together and holding each other accountable. So I think that, number one, obviously, now you have the resource to get the right mentors in place. you know, places for people to go, create things and activities and ways to get there. I think those are important things. But again, I think that these kids, you know, I had role models of color when I was younger, and, you know, you look at soccer, basketball, women's basketball, baseball, you know, the diversity is amazing. So now for us to kind of take that first step and really supplant ourselves, commit ourselves to these individual communities, I think the more they can see the investment, I think it has it'll have a lasting impression. So I hope that answers the question.
Next question is from Ashley Lane. How are teams planning to share their progress with their initiatives? Is there a centralized location we can follow? I presume that probably Renata.
Yeah, sure. The playequityfund.org website is where we're, you know, we'll be tracking our progress and the impact that we're making in communities. We're also forming an advisory group that will be representative of that will be representatives from each of the teams, so that we can continue to work in collaboration. You know, I think it was mentioned earlier, you know, that right now we're being still and present because of safer at home protocols. And very little sports going on at the moment. But when the sports programs do start to engage and the teams start playing, you know, we want to make sure we still have an ongoing connection between Play Equity and the Alliance. And so that advisory group was being set up to be able to do that exact thing. And the playequityfund.org website is where information can be received in terms of the progress that we're making toward our goals.
All right, Michael Horn from CRN Radio is directing his question to Dennis and John of the Angels. How will the Alliance work with schools in light of the current COVID-19 shutdown?
Are we muted? We're going to continue to work through the Boys and Girls Clubs and other organizations throughout the area. We have a big impact within the schools, and we're waiting just like a lot of other organizations to wait to see what develops as it relates to the kids getting back in school. We are in contact with all the school administrators, trying to find alternative means to try to reach the kids. If COVID prolongs their departure from getting back into the classrooms.
Next question comes from Jim Hill, directed to Sean and Dave Roberts again. How can sports help all of us get through these difficult times?
Go ahead, Coach. Go ahead, Dave. I'll let you take this one.
You know what? I think that's a great question. I think that, you know, sports has always been a place where people can, you know, bring families, relive childhoods, and it's generational. I think that this time in our country where people are encouraged to be at home, we're not going to be having fans as far as, you know, in the near future. I think that it's going to be a different experience. I think that, you know, for us, for opening day, you're going to have families watching baseball at their home, something certainly different, but the conversations are going to be different. There's going to be more time together. I think it's certainly a nice diversion. I think for me, these are the best athletes that I've ever seen collectively in all sports across industries, and they're special talent. So I think that, yeah, they're not going to be in the ballparks or in the arenas or in the stadiums, but I think that seeing these great people play, and I think, Jimmy, also is that there's going to be a lot of stories like the Alliance Los Angeles that are going to come about, that with TV people are going to get to hear different stories and really get to know these players on a different level. And I think that humanness, which has really happened with social media and media itself, I think is going to be great to connect the fans with people they admire, you know, on the field and on the court, et cetera.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more with what Dave said there. And you know, I think the thing that's so special about sports is everybody likes being a part of something bigger than themselves. And then especially when you talk about what the Alliance is representative of, different people coming together to achieve a common goal. And I said it earlier, but I think the best part of sports specific to what we're talking about here is those prejudices, those stereotypes are eliminated because people are able to just get to know one another. They're trying to achieve a common goal. And I think our job, especially as leaders, is make sure that we do an excellent job. We say, hey, everybody loves being a part of something bigger than themselves as long as they feel like their role contributes to the outcome. And I think one of the challenges, and I've talked a lot about this with other coaches, is how can we authentically find value? Certainly Jared Goff and Aaron Donald are going to be very important parts of the Rams' success, but how do we make sure that that guy that was an undrafted free agent understands that his role can contribute to the better of the outcomes that we're trying to achieve, but most importantly, just stack blocks consistently day in and day out. I believe that consistency compounds, and I believe that's what's so special about sports is people being able to see that. I've been a part in a short period of time going into the fourth season with the Rams where, unfortunately, we've had some different adversities that you've seen football and sports really be able to provide a relief for things that are a lot bigger than sports, whether it's the fires, there was shootings a couple years ago in Thousand Oaks. When we played in that Monday night football game against the Chiefs, the power of what that did to be able to represent some of the family members that were a part of victims of the shooting or people that were going through these wildfires and seeing everybody just kind of have a relief and be able to come root for a team that was connected and loves one another. That was special. And I think you want to continue to use that platform for the right reasons, Jim.
All right. Thank you, Coach. Our next question comes from John Davis of Wave Newspapers. He directs the question to the Rams, Chargers, and the Clippers. Can you each think of an example on how the Alliance can specifically benefit the city of Inglewood? Anybody want to tackle that one?
Well, go ahead, Coach, if you want to go. Or
go ahead, AD. I'll let you go ahead.
Thank you. Well, I think it's important to understand that the Alliance doesn't take place. It really just complements some of the things that we've already been doing in Inglewood and will continue to do, such as, you know, our Play 60 camps with the youth in Inglewood. And, you know, just we donated new football uniforms to Morningside and Inglewood High School in collaboration with the Rams. And we donated bikes to Koo Elementary. You know, these things are going to continue to happen with the Alliance then supplementing and creating more opportunity. So I think that's important to underscore.
Yeah, I think when you look at, you know, the intent of this program, you know, it's uniting to really address racial injustice and to create educational opportunities for a fair playing field. And there's a lot of different ways where that collaboration, whether you're a Rams fan, whether you're a Chargers fan, you know, I think all 11 teams, when you talk about the power of just the sports platform and everybody coming together, it's then implementing these things with Renata. You know, Tom has been instrumental in starting this up, but it's really the actions now putting them into place. And then like Jim asked myself and Dave earlier, it's really just having those actions align with, okay, do we have tangible progress and what can we do to make sure that there's a bunch of different avenues that really resonate with our players? That's the thing, or people of our organization. Asking so many different questions that maybe I'm embarrassed to admit that I haven't asked before has really given me some insight onto the sticking points or the things that people are passionate about based on their experiences and their environments. And I think educating our players on what they can do and then helping them identify, and people like Molly Higgins in our organization have been instrumental in really doing those things and setting up our players or staff members to truly make an impact. And I'm, you know, thankful for the Alliance for being able to do something that's exactly in alignment with what we're all talking about here today.
And then on behalf of the Clippers, what I would say is, you know, we really see the Alliance as an opportunity to extend the work that we're already doing in the community of Inglewood. So I think people are pretty familiar with the enormous capital project we've taken on to renovate courts in and around Los Angeles, but that extends into Inglewood as well. And last year we were able to renovate all of the courts at the Crozier Middle School, which is a place where, you know, a lot of youth have access to the opportunity to play a variety of different sports. Programming at these facilities is also really important, and I think that's a place where the Alliance can begin to take action. And this is something that can benefit sports beyond basketball.
Thank you, Gillian. Cameron Buford has two questions. The first goes to Renata. Will there be job opportunities and career development opportunities for young adults 16 to 21 to further assist in the molding and growth of these young adults?
Yeah, thank you for the question. And I think exactly what we're looking to do. And just on a personal note, you know, I grew up in the city of Carson. My dad was a butcher. My mom was a grocery clerk. I knew I didn't want to do that thing, but I didn't know what other opportunities existed for me. I was a huge sports fan, played three sports in middle school and high school. And so the work that we're doing, you know, really resonates to me personally, because we're really exposing these young kids that we're gonna be engaged with to career opportunities within the sports field. You know, it's like that famous adage, if she can see it, she can be it. And so this partnership, this alliance, the work we're gonna engage in over the next 5 years is providing an opportunity for the kids that we're working with and for the programs and the organizations that we're working with to know that they can be an executive, you know, for the Clippers or the Dodgers or the Lakers, that they could, you know, be a videographer, that they can be a writer. You know, this is a moment and an opportunity for us to create both access and opportunities through this leadership cohort that we're going to be engaging with, so they can aspire you know, through sport, not to just have success on the field, but to have success off the field. And I should say that each of the teams, you know, is doing, you know, their individual work, and many are in the Alliance are leading on that effort to make sure, you know, that their front offices and their organizations reflect the communities in which they play in which they serve. So yes, this is a critical component and piece of the work that we're going to be engaged in over the next 5 years.
Cameron also had a question for Sean McVay, Dave Roberts, and Gillian Zucker. Will you encourage your players to participate with the various Alliance initiatives?
I think the first thing I would say for us is absolutely, but I don't even necessarily think we'll have to encourage guys. It's been an extremely powerful demonstration over these last couple months of having intimate conversations, whether it be one-on-one or in team settings, where this is something that our players are passionate and serious about. And I think what they've all said, and they kind of challenged me and really our organization from day one when we first had a team meeting, that so many different men shared, and it was really a powerful perspective that we were able to gain. But they want to see now, let's put some tangible actions in place and not just talk about it. So we will certainly encourage it, but I think the best part about what we've got going with the Rams is so many of our players are passionate. It's in their heart to really contribute and to make a difference. And I think this provides an outstanding opportunity for them to do that with the city of LA and these 10 other organizations on this call through Alliance.
Yeah, and I think for us, obviously with each organization, we're doing individually as an organization, you know, in the communities. This alliance just allows for another vehicle for us to get into the communities. And I think that with numbers, there's power. And I think that the collection of all of us. So again, I just think that it's just, yes, to the question, our guys will certainly be encouraged, but I don't think they're going to need to be encouraged. I think they're excited to be a part of it, for again, the greater good. So, you know, everyone's doing it individually, but collectively, this is going to be really fun to see how it takes off.
It's hard to add more than what the coaches have already said. I mean, these guys, this is what they love to do. And you talk to a player about attending a press conference, they're not that excited about being a talking head, but you give them an opportunity to go to a playground and play with a bunch of kids and you can't drag them away. So I'm very confident you'll see lots of players involved in the Alliance.
Thank you. Another question from Jim Hill. This one's to Blake. in a sport like hockey that is predominantly white, how can the Kings and Ducks make an impact on this initiative?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, it's truthful. Hockey is a predominantly white sport. And with that, we're just really trying to eradicate racism around the world of hockey and really create some inclusion within our game. I think number one, we just have to be diligent in expressing to our fans that we want to diversify and we want to bring people of color into our game because representation matters. I think going out there in the communities, having ball hockey initiatives, working with YMCAs and other LA public schools is going to be something that we're definitely going to do. And, you know, we have a lot of initiatives coming up. We just launched our LA Kings Inclusive Initiative today, which we're really excited about. And I think with our executive committee, you'll see a lot of things coming out of the LA Kings, and I'm sure with the Ducks as well.
Thank you. Jim also said the announcement of the Alliance today is the reason why we can call our city the sports capital of the world and is also an example for other cities. Next question comes from Dennis Freeman and the calls for social justice. How important is it for these organizations to factor in the outreach to members of the Black press as well as other ethnic groups to carry out your messages of equity, leadership, and inclusion? Who'd like to tackle that one, Renata?
Join our movement. I think it's as simple as that. You know, I think a point that I'd make is in the conversation we had with the sports teams and taking and being patient in listening and not rushing to respond. And as I said earlier, you know, this is an opportunity for us to continue the conversation. You know, more than six weeks ago, you know, the deaths of Breonna Taylor and George Floyd and so many others at the hands of, you know, police officers really, you know, I think shook the world once again. I worked in LA for Mark Ridley Thomas after the civil unrest doing community organizing. You know, so I know from personal experience, from work experience, you know, the despair that communities continue to face, the injustices and the inequality, you know, in Black and brown communities. And, you know, there comes a time when the smoldering of buildings being burned down or the protests stop being put on television, that people forget that communities are still suffering. And I'm excited and grateful for this alliance coming together and the teams putting forth their resources and their team assets, their players, their leadership, not just through the partnership with the Play Equity Fund, to continue to be vocal, to speak truth to power to these communities that struggle, to these young kids who struggle. So that 5 years ago, we're talking 5 years from now, we're talking about the impact that we're making. We're talking about the lives of kids that we're changing and helping them, you know, become their best selves and realize their true potential. And we're also talking about the work still yet to be done. To Tim Harris's point, you know, at the 5 year mark, we're going to celebrate the success and impact that we've had, and then we're going to re-up for another 5 years because it takes that long. You know, 400 years of racism and slavery. We're not going to eradicate that overnight. And I think the more the press and the media can continue to shine a light on and talk about and give voice to young people and to community organizations, you know, about the inequities that exist, but then also celebrate the success and the impact that we are having, I think is a responsibility for all of us. I am a true believer. When people come together and work in collaboration from the greater good, the good things can happen. And I'm looking forward to good things happening in partnership with the Alliance.
Thank you, Renata. I'd like to thank everyone, these leaders, for all getting together today for this great announcement. I'd like to thank the media for joining us. If anyone needs to reach out to Ricky Zeller at LA84 or us at BZA or any of the PR directors of the teams, feel free to do so. We thank you for joining us today, and we look forward to the Alliance doing great things for the city of Greater Los Angeles. Thank you.